It's time for the Saturday Morning Sports Page on Sports Radio KGSO.
Well, good morning and welcome in to the Saturday Morning Sports Page, our very first one of this fall football season. Doug Downs in studio this morning. You want to be a part of the show? We welcome in your phone calls on our Maximum Outdoor Equipment hotlines at 522-1410. I do have the streaming channels up and running. YouTube, Facebook Live, Twitch.tv, and Twitter. That's where you can find the Saturday Morning Sports Page right here on Fox Sports Radio Wichita KGSO. So we got a lot to get to from last night as the high school football season, it officially kicked off on Thursday with Bishop Carroll and Northwest High School. The Golden Eagles get a 10-point win. We will bring you a little snippet of that game a little bit later on in the show. We will also talk to head coach Dusty Trail here coming up about 10 minutes after 7 o'clock. Got a couple of coaches lined out for today, and one of them is Dusty Trail. That will happen at about 10 minutes after the hour here. The other one is Coach Brent Pfeiffer from Mays South. The Mavericks get a big win on the road last night at Great Bend. I'm trying to get the show shared to our KGSO page. And see, this is where I need Mason. He does this for me in the mornings when we do the game plan because I don't know enough about Facebook on how to do all this. All right, here we go. I think I got it done. So now you can check out the show on Facebook Live. 522-1410. You can weigh in at any time. But let's get to some scores from last night. We had a rainy night last night. We had thunderstorms that rolled in. So some of the games did not get completed from week number one last night in high school football. But let me give you kind of where we are in the scores of games that did get completed and games that are still being played as far as that goes. So let's start out in 6A. Dodge City came to town, and they took care of Wichita West last night, 28-6. In the battle of two teams that finished last in the City League last year, storied programs, a lot of history before these two teams, but Southeast and North played each other last night, and it was the Golden Buffaloes winning the game 28-6 on their home field. So the struggles continue for Wichita North. CAPA Mount Carmel made a statement last night as they beat South High 55-0. Hutchinson took care of Valley Center 34-6. Salinas Central beat Campus 44-6. Mays and Andover, 17-7 was the score I had. It says that they are in the third. I don't know if they just didn't get a final in or if they still need to come back and play that game and if it was postponed due to the thunderstorms and the rain. So right now, Mays 17-7 over Andover. If you know if that's a final score, you can call and let me know. But that's what I have at this point in time. McPherson beats Salina South 24-14. Heights gets a City League win. They start out 1-0 in a tough battle against Goddard Eisenhower. The Falcons win that game 28-23. Hayes took care of Wichita East 35-6. Now, I knew Hayes was going to have a pretty good football team this year, but Wichita East is one of those teams that we expect to contend in the City League. But the Blue Aces took one on the chin out west as Hayes beat them 35-6. Augusta beats Coffeyville 48-0. Winfield and Arc City. Winfield holds a 3-0 lead. That game is postponed. El Dorado took care of Independence 36-0. Buehler makes a statement last night in a big way, going up against what was expected to be a pretty good Goddard Lions team. Head coach Tommy Beeson at Goddard. We talked to him earlier this year on the game plan, and he thought highly of his team, thought they had a good summer workout. But, man, Buehler makes a statement last night. They take care of the Lions 42-14. Mays South all over Great Bend, 32-0. Again, head coach of Mays South, Brent Pfeiffer, on the show this morning about 7:20. Silver Lake beats Rock Creek, 34-28. Topeka Hayden over Emporia, 22-2. Chaparral beats Wichita Trinity, 36-0. Smoky Valley beats Halstead 20-16. Halstead usually always has a really, really good team, so that tells me that Smoky Valley is going to have one of their years where we may be talking about them late into November. Andale continues to roll, make it 28 in a row now for the Indians as they roll up Rose Hill 57-6 last night. Collegian beats Mulvane by 10, 24-14. Sedgwick scores 61. That is the highest point total that I've seen so far from the night, and they take care of Sterling 61-8. Clearwater beats Belle Plaine 48-0. Cheney, which is expected to be a very good football team this year, they take care of Kingman 34-14. Heston over Haven 45-8. Remington and Douglas, they are tied at 22 apiece. That game, I believe, got called off in the fourth quarter, so I'm not sure when they're going to play that. Hillsboro over Nickerson 50-22. So that's the scores that I have from around the area. If I missed one and you know of one, feel free to call in, and I'd love to hear from you. If we look at things that happened to the east of us last night, Blue Valley North beat Bishop Miege 51-24. Bishop Miege in 4A, they usually step out and always play a tough 6A, 5A schedule during the regular season. So it's not a surprise. Bishop Miege typically will take a couple of losses throughout the year. But, man, that team gets prepared to play in that 4A state championship, which they usually do every year. Junction City all over Topeka, 34-0. Lawrence Free State, they struggled last year, but typically a pretty good program. They beat Shawnee Mission Northwest 49-21. Lawrence beat Olathe East 28-7. Blue Valley Northwest beat Blue Valley 35-21. Shawnee Mission East took care of Shawnee Mission North 28-7. Olathe Northwest beat Olathe West 28-21. Mill Valley tops Gardner Edgington 35-14. And Shawnee Mission West loses to Olathe South 7-6. Olathe North beats Shawnee Mission South 56-0. And Manhattan beats Garden City 21-7. So giving you some scores out east there. So the game that I haven't talked about last night was a game that we had over on our sister station, KQAM. Had a nice time last night down in Conway Springs. Man, it's the kind of football that, you know, when I grew up back in the mid-80s, we played this kind of football. It's huddle up between every play. It's run a couple of tight ends, hand the ball off a lot, and just try to get 3 or 4 yards every carry, move the chains, march down the field, eat up some clock, and you get out of there with a low-scoring game. That's what we had last night in the first half with Conway Springs and Garden Plain. The reason why I say the first half is because at halftime, we get an announcement from the stadium announcer that there was going to be a 45-minute rain delay. When I got down to Conway Springs last night, about a quarter till 5, you could tell that things were starting to build to the south and the west of us, and it was only a matter of time before the storm was going to roll through. And about 15 minutes into that 45-minute rain delay, they made the decision that this game was not going to get restarted last night. So they stopped the game at half. They will restart it today, if weather permitting, at 1 o'clock this afternoon. But it was a 7-6 game, scoreless game in the first quarter. Conway Springs finally gets off the snide. They get in with a 27-yard touchdown run to take a 7-0 lead. Then right before half, Garden Plain comes back, and they get their touchdown. Here's what it sounded like last night with the call.
Slot man comes in motion. Adelhart again, handoff, coming near side, trying to follow some blockers. Has some. Adelhart touchdown. Reed Adelhart makes a cut off of a perfect block thrown by Tegan Darr and steps into the end zone. They are an extra point away from tying this football game up.
And they couldn't get the extra point. So 7-6 is the score at half between Garden Plain and Conway Springs. The Cardinals lead it by 1. And again this afternoon at 1 o'clock is when those two teams will resume. It's a lot of fun. If you have time today and if the weather permits, I would suggest anybody get down to Conway Springs and go check out that game because it is a lot of fun to watch those two teams play. It's kind of a little bit of that old school football, but it's a lot of fun to get out and enjoy a little old school football between a couple of teams that are projected to be pretty good in the Central Plains League. There's only 3 passes thrown in that game. We're going to try to get a hold of Dusty Trell here real quick for Bishop Carroll. Only 3 passes between both teams in that game. that was being played last night.
Hello.
Hey, Coach. You're on the air, so don't say bad things about me, okay?
All right.
How you doing?
I'm doing all right. How's it going?
It's going good. It's our first Saturday morning sports page that we do every Saturday during the fall. Come in, run down some scores. But, man, it's probably a good thing you guys got your game in Thursday night because the weather did not cooperate with us to open up the high school football season.
Oh, man, it came in like a hammer for sure last night. I was curious. You know, I know some people had moved the start time of their games up, and it turns out they were probably smart to do that to get them in. I don't know how many games got postponed last night, but I'm sure several of them did.
Well, as I look through my sheet, the good news is I only have about four that looks like they were maybe stopped in the third, fourth, or at halftime. There may have been more, but from what I've been able to find this morning, that's about all there was. Because you're right, a lot of teams did move their start times up, some of them at 5:30, some of them at 6. And I think if they wouldn't have got some games in. We were down in Conway Springs last night, and they had to stop that game at half.
Is that right?
Yeah, it was one of those deals that when I got there a little bit before 5 o'clock, you could see the storms building to the south and the west. And I knew that there was no way we were playing a full football game based off of the way things looked even a little bit before 5 o'clock.
Right. Now, do they have a rescheduled time or anything like that?
Supposed to start it up today at 1 o'clock if this weather moves out. Right now, the good news is I think we have just mostly rain. I haven't seen any thunder or lightning this morning.
Right.
So we can go play football in the rain. That's kind of fun sometimes.
That's right. That's right. You know, especially if you have not too many of them around, but if you have a natural grass field, that makes it even more fun.
They have that down in Conway Springs. Well, congratulations on the big win on Thursday night. Head coach Dusty Trail from the Bishop Carroll Golden Eagles joining us here on the sports page. And, man, what an exciting game. And, you know, at some point in time when we were calling the game, I told Walt, my broadcast partner, I said, I feel like I'm watching a heavyweight fight right now. We usually get that every year when you get together with Northwest.
Yeah, no doubt, you know. It was a lot of fun, you know, kind of nerve-wracking from a coaching perspective. But, you know, I thought both teams for game one came out and, you know, mistakes were made, obviously, by both sides. You know, you're always going to get that in a game one situation. You know, first time in, I don't know, you know, over a year that, you know, either any of these kids have played in front of a crowd, and there was a big crowd there. And, you know, so that lended itself to nervousness, jitters. And again, you're going to get mistakes because of that. And then, of course, the weather conditions, it was very hot. But I thought both teams showed just tremendous heart. Bouncing back, both teams were, like you said, just kind of making big plays and bouncing back. And, you know, so there's a lot of momentum shifts. And I thought our kids did a great job of that's probably what I was most impressed with, was just how they reacted to all the things that went on, you know, all the good and the bad. They maintained their poise pretty well, and that's pretty unusual for a young team. You know, we had a lot of young kids playing, they reacted pretty well. Now, maybe it's because they didn't know any better. I don't know, but it was a fun game to start out with. Sure.
No, it was a lot of fun, and you mentioned that it was pretty hot. When you see me on Tuesday, I'm going to be 25 pounds lighter because we spent 4 hours in a sauna in that press box trying to
– No air conditioning up there.
No air conditioning, and it was pretty warm. Between last night's game and the game Thursday night, I'm pretty sure I lost a little bit of weight over the last 2 days. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
How did you kind of prepare the kids for the heat? You'd practice in it all week. When we got together for the coaches show on Tuesday, you were talking about the heat. How did you get the because I was quite shocked to see that we didn't have any stoppage in play from cramps. So that means both coaches, both teams did a good job of really spending the week hydrating their players.
Right. Yeah, and that's something we talked a lot about. You know, in a situation like that, obviously you got to practice in the heat. to get the guys to understand what it's going to feel like and what it's going to do to their bodies. But we talked a lot about the proper nutrition and hydration aspect of things throughout the entire week in preparation for it. You know, we talked to our kids about preparing for those hot games, and you have to prepare about a week in advance. You got to start hydrating a little more, getting more electrolytes in. We talked about a lot about getting the extra electrolytes every day, the Powerade, the Gatorade, the Pedialyte. There's lots of different options out there. And our trainer did a great job of educating our kids on what they needed to do. So I think the combination of all that kind of, it bore out, that kind of helped us out, I think. And, some of the guys you saw limping around out there were from cramping, and they were trying to fight through it, and, on Northwest side as well. So there was some cramping going on out there. Wasn't a situation where, it was stopping the game a lot and those types of things.
A couple of things stood out to me from the game. First of all, I thought Chase Marsh, your quarterback, first time starting, played a really nice game. He made a couple of throws. That 78-yarder that he hit Matt Holthusen on. Holthusen made a great run after the catch, but Chase made just a terrific throw between a couple of defenders to get that touchdown. So I thought he played well. I thought Matt played very well. But the thing that sticks out to me the most is you guys had a little bit of a challenge in the first half controlling Jeremiah Moore, their quarterback, and he's tough to control. The kid is just a great athlete and got speed all over the place. But I thought in the second half defensively, you played a little bit more disciplined to where your guys – they played their spot on the field, so when Jeremiah Moore crossed their face, they were in the right position and prepared to make the tackle.
Right, exactly. Our kids settled down. I think they were, maybe not playing aggressively enough in the first half, playing tentative, and trying to keep Jeremiah in front of them. He's the type of kid that he's not going to stay in front of you. he's kind of – yeah, he's got enough moves, enough quickness, and enough acceleration that, he's just not going to stay in front of you. So we were playing tentative, kind of, trying to stay in front of him, and that wasn't working too well. I think we got more aggressive in the second half and attacked him, made him cut immediately. Plus, we were getting a lot of guys to the football. Our guys were pursuing very well, which caught us a couple of times because he cut it back on us, and we didn't have any cutback, defenders back there. So, credit to him, too, for recognizing that. But, I think our guys really came out in the second half and played more aggressively and got after it a little bit more. Which is going to pay dividends down the line, I think.
You had a really good third quarter. It's where you kind of opened things up. You got out to a 17-point lead. Northwest comes back, cuts the lead back down to 10. But then you get back down there towards the goal line and give credit to Northwest and their defense. They get awful stingy in the red zone. You have first and goal from about the 1, and you can't punch it in. So you go for it, and I thought this right here was kind of the nail in the coffin. You go for it on fourth down, and this is what happens.
Three receivers in the game, two split off to the left. It's a short side of the field. One receiver here on the near side. It's Tate Blasey, one-on-one coverage. Blasey gets away. Blasey,
touchdown.
Tate Blasey
nice
with
call.
An in-and-out move, and Chase Marsh put it right on the number to give the Bishop Carroll Golden Eagles a 16-point lead.
So Tate had a nice game as a junior.
Yeah.
And that was just a terrific route that he ran right there. It was a little bit of a Z route back to the corner of the end zone, and Chase put it right on the money, and that pretty much iced the game for you right there.
Yeah, we knew they were driving down hard on our slant routes, which is, the play before we had tried a slant, and Chase didn't throw it, pulled it down because there was really, they got good corners out there, really tight coverage. Which I thought Chase, that was a good decision on his part. not throwing that and scrambled around. And, you know, of course, they got a great defensive line and weren't able to get it in, wasn't able to use his feet to get it in. So, you know, that 3 points, you know, we talked about kicking the field goal, but that really wasn't going to get us much.
Yeah, it doesn't do you any good at that point.
No, it was going to get us up by 13. Well, that's still two scores. So we decided to go ahead and try and make it a three-score game, and ended up working out for us. And the kids executed the play very well. So
yeah, Northwest does come back and add a score. So it's a 10-point win, 37-27.
Right.
So now in this young season, here's what we have. You are sitting there at 1-0. Your Catholic brothers at Capon sitting at 1-0 after a nice win over South last night. And
yep.
Heights gets a close win over Goddard Eisenhower, so they set at 1-0. So that's the three teams right. atop the City League right now.
Yeah. You know, and Heights got a lot of talent over there, and you know, Coach Dingle does a good job with those kids and gets them going. And they're doing some new things offensively over at Heights, which I think is going to help them out. You know, they're getting their athletes in space, getting them the ball. So they're going to be tough to defend. And they always play well on defense. So, you know, I completely expected them to be up there. And of course, Capon and Coach Schartz, you know, they're always going to come at you. And they always have a good team. And they're well coached. And they're going to get after you offensively and pound the ball at you, play physical football. And they're going to play good defense. So, you know, nothing I didn't expect out of those guys week one. And you know, it's just an indication it's going to be a fun season.
Yeah, well, it's a good position to be in. Congratulations on a week number one win. We'll see you Tuesday night for the coaches show over at Two Brothers Barbecue.
All right, sounds great. Thanks, Doug.
All right, thanks, Dusty. There he goes, Dusty Trail. Head coach Bishop Carroll Golden Eagles, big win to start the season on Thursday. Coming up next on the other side of the break, we're going to talk to Brent Pfeiffer. He's the head coach for the Mays South Mavericks. They go out to Great Bend and pitch a shutout. It's the Saturday Morning Sports Page. Thanks for waking up with us this morning.
Hi, I'm Brian Davis with Davis Liquor Outlet.
And I'm Blake Davis. When you're stocking up for your summer party needs, don't forget to save with our great discount days. On Tuesday, save 10% on all 750 milliliter bottles of liquor.
Wednesday, save 15% on craft and imported beers.
And Thursday, save 20% on most wines.
Seniors and military save 10% every day.
And don't forget to visit DavisLiquorOutlet.com to sign up for monthly coupons and to find a store near you.
Davis Liquor Outlet, each store independently owned and operated.
Excludes 31st Meridian.
Rich in history and experience, Anderson & Forrester have been the leading manufacturer for tools in the natural gas industry since 1928. Anderson & Forrester have dominated the industry for LP and natural gas orifices,
gauging drills,
broaches, reamers, and special tools to support the gas service industry. Whatever your needs may be in drilling or natural gas, look to the experts. Anderson & Forrester. Call them at 800-745-4466. Find them on Facebook or on their website at andersonforrester.com.
It's time for you to get away at the Getaway Lounge in Garden Plain. The Getaway Lounge is the perfect place for you to get away with friends or family. With happy hour every day of the week between 2 to 6 p.m., you can enjoy great food, drinks, and their specials. Plus, they have the covered back patio for you to kick back and relax. Plus, it's the perfect getaway to go and enjoy the big game on any of their big screen TVs.
The Getaway Lounge in Garden Plain, Kansas.
428 North Main Street in Garden Plain. Dine in, take out, or just go to Getaway. Make sure to follow them on Facebook.
At Kansas Motor Company, 6717 West Kellogg Drive, right next to Texas Roadhouse, you'll find gently used pre-owned vehicles. You see, Kansas Motor Company stands above their competition by putting each vehicle through an extensive inspection. And they provide you with a Carfax so you know if there's any bumps in the vehicle's history. And when it comes to your history, bad credit, no problem. Easy finance terms at Kansas Motor Company, next to Texas Roadhouse on West Kellogg or online at kansasmotorcompany.com.
We're in optometry at 21st and Tyler with a few words about computer vision syndrome or digital eye strain. It's a real thing. In the past couple of years, a lot of us have found ourselves with increased time staring at computer screens. Warren Optometry knows that prolonged time looking at the computer screen can cause eye strain, headaches, blurred vision, or dry eyes. Warren Optometry can prescribe lenses specifically for computer use. Warren Optometry, WAREN Optometry.com.
Stackline Communications once again proud to present the Monster Truck Show at the Kansas State Fair. 3 o'clock Sunday afternoon, September 12th at the Kansas State Fair Grandstand. Gates open at 1:30. During this Sunday event, you can take a ride on a real monster truck. Monster Patrol truck rides available prior to and after the show. Get ready for an hour and a half of Monster Truck Mania. The show runs rain or shine. Monster Trucks at the Kansas State Fair, September 12th, brought to you by Stackline Communications.
See, this is what happens when I get to talking to Coach Pfeiffer during the break. I missed my cue to come back. Coach, thanks. I missed my cue to come back. We were talking too much.
Sorry about that.
That's all right. It's not your fault. It's mine. I wasn't paying attention. How you doing, man? I know it was a late night for you guys at Mays South. Coach Brent Pfeiffer on with us now. Coming back from Great Bend. Probably had to come through a little bit of rain. So you guys got back kind of late last night, huh?
Yeah, you know. Football season when you come home and everybody's asleep and then you wake up and everybody's still asleep, so we're off and running.
That's the way it works. So what's the schedule? Do you guys get together on Saturday mornings typically and do some film work or workouts or anything?
Yeah, you know, typically we get the kids up and it's more of a probably rehab thing if anybody's got anything, just to kind of touch base and see if anybody has anything, talk to the kids if they're going out to college games and make contact with recruiters, and we'll watch a little bit of film, but it's about an hour. This week with the weekend, we gave the families some time because we've got extra time on Monday to get some things done. So, yeah, most Saturdays we just bring them up for an hour or so and just kind of visit and get everybody's heads in the right spot going forward.
Well, last night you'd make a trip out to Great Bend, usually a tough place to go out and play, but a nice showing. You pitch a shutout and get a 32-0 win against Great Bend. What impressed you the most last night about your football team?
I think probably the defense played, you know, a little better than we expected. You know, they got a lot of new faces over there and a new coordinator and Shane Harden and changing some things up, and it's been you know, a question mark. You know, not doing it before. We had 12 years of kind of doing our thing, and so switching things up is always a little nervous, but those kids came out and really communicated really well.
Looks like offensively putting up 32 points, that's a pretty good output. I know you guys like to play at a very fast pace. You're bringing a new quarterback in as a starter this year after Colin left last year after being a starter for about 3 years over there. Offensively, do you feel like things were really on track for you last night?
Yeah, I think we did some really good things offensively. We moved the ball really well. You know, a lot of young guys over there too, a new quarterback. And Evan Cantu ran so hard last night. I think he had 23 carries for 238 or something like that. So, you know, new guys on the O-line did a great job in the run game. You know, we just had some miscues, some great drives, big plays, and then, you know, self-inflicted wounds with a few penalties here and there, calling some things back, and some misreads and throwing interceptions down inside. That, you know, I think we threw two of them, actually, where we were at the goal line or inside the 10. So, you know, we left several points on the board, too. But, you know, what's encouraging about that is, you know, things that we can fix. Things under our control, so moving forward we've got a lot of positives.
Well, you play in such a tough league in this AVCTL, and some good teams out there. Goddard kind of took one on the chin last night to Buehler, 42-14, so the Crusaders up there at Buehler must be a pretty good football team, because I know Tommy Beeson was expecting his squad to be pretty good. Eisenhower plays a tight game with Heights, 28-23. Eisenhower loses. Mays, last score I had, they were in the third against Andover with a 17-7 lead. Now, I don't know if that game got completed and we just didn't get a score, or if they got to come back and play that today. Hutch rolls up Valley Center 34-6. I'm just giving you some people in the AVCTL that you're going to see along the way, because you got some pretty tough competition coming up.
Yeah, there's a lot of guys. Kind of like Great Bend. Great Bend brought something like 18 or 19 starters back.
Wow.
And I think there's several teams in our league this year that are doing that. We unfortunately are not one of them. But so you know, there should be some really good competition this year, and some great games to be at and watch, and hopefully some big crowds this year. That'll be different than last year. Hopefully some big crowds to get behind the kids and just make the environment what it should be.
Well, if Thursday night is any indication of how bad people missed high school football over at Northwest, because I don't know what the final numbers were, but I'm guessing somewhere around 6,000 people showed up and the atmosphere was electric. It ought to be a lot of fun this year for you guys and for your kids.
Oh, I think, you know, we played 2 hours away in Great Bend, and, you know, we had a solid crowd travel out there, and the cowbells were ringing, and Great Bend's a fantastic place to play. If people haven't played out there, you need to sign up and get out there. It's a lot of fun. That's a great environment. So we're looking forward to doing some more of that.
Yeah, they usually take football pretty seriously out there in Great Bend. And storied program. I mean, over the years, they've had obviously some very good teams. Who do you got coming up next week on the schedule?
Salina South will travel to our place, so we get a home game. And, you know, Coach Sellers has got a great club coming down. So they played a good one last night against Ferson. He's a really good team. And we got a lot of guys back, so we'll have to be ready.
All right, Salina South over at Mays South next week. Well, you'll get a chance to see that home crowd, and it'll be a good atmosphere. Coach, appreciate you taking some time this morning. Go back to bed, man. You were up too late last night.
Well, if I could put this computer away, I'd probably do that. I'm just looking forward to watching some good college games today, too, and seeing crowds in the stands again. And, you know, just ready for some football.
What game's going to get your attention today on the college level?
I don't have one picked. I have all of them. Probably after last year, the one that I turn on with the loudest crowd and the best scenery.
There you go. Well, we got a lot of good ones on tap today. We're going to run down some of the college football stuff coming up here in the next segment. All right, buddy. Well, thanks. I appreciate you taking some time joining us this morning. Congratulations on a week one win, and keep this thing rolling out there at May South.
Anytime, Doug. Great to visit with you, and sorry for keeping you a little behind on schedule.
Oh, that's all right. That's my life. It happens all the time. Appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, buddy.
See you next time. There he goes, Coach Brent Pfeiffer with the Mays South Mavericks. Good guy. Love talking to Coach Fife, and he's off to a good start. Let me run down scores for you again. If you want to call in, 522-1410, that's our maximum outdoor equipment hotlines. You can call the show this morning. Man, can you tell that I'm kind of running on fumes right now? I'll be honest with you. I mean, between a Thursday night game, and it was just such a great game, and it takes a lot out of you, and it was hot in that press box, sweating like crazy. And then last night going down to Conway Springs, and even though the game got called at half, it was a good atmosphere and a good game, and again, inside of a hot press box, doing the show yesterday. So I apologize if my energy level is not where it typically is, because I'm kind of running on fumes right now. But let me run down some scores for you. Dodge City takes care of West 28-6. Southeast and North played each other. It was the Buffaloes getting a win on their home field, the stadium that just opened up last year, 28-6. Cape of Mount Carmel rolls up South High. The Crusaders, they are going to be a really, really good football team this year under the direction of Weston Charts. That matchup with Bishop Carroll later on in the year at Cessna Stadium at Wichita State is going to be a barn burner. But Capen beat South 55-0. We heard from head coach Dusty Trail at Bishop Carroll. They beat Northwest on Thursday, 37-27. Salina Central beats Campus 44-6. Hutchinson takes care of Valley Center 34-6. Mike Vernon over at Hutch has the Salt Hawks, I think, back to being a contender. Just told you a minute ago that Mays is on top of Andover 17-7. I don't know if that game got completed or not, because according to my sheet, it says that they were in the third quarter. McPherson beats Salina South 24-10. Heights and Eisenhower, a game that did get into a rain delay. I think the game finished up last night somewhere around 11:30, but Heights wins 28-23. Hayes with a statement over Wichita East, a team that was supposed to contend for the City League as well. The Blue Aces fall 35-6 to Hayes. Augusta beats Coffeyville 48-0. Winfield and Arc City. Winfield has a 3-point lead, and the game was postponed until today. El Dorado beats Independence 36-0. Buehler, the Crusaders, Steve Warner's team, makes a statement over Tommy Beeson's Goddard Lions with a 42-14 win. We just heard from Coach Fife. Mays South beats Great Bend 32-0. Silver Lake beats Rock Creek 34-28. Topeka Hayden on top of Emporia 22-2. Chaparral took care of Wichita Trinity 36-0. Smoky Valley has a good football team this year as they beat Halstead 20-16. Andale, they make it 28 wins in a row as the Indians take care of Rose Hill 57-6. That score, I think, before they even got out of the first quarter, was 36-0. Collegiate beats Mulvane 24-14. Sedgwick scores the most points of any school that we've seen from last night's game. They roll up 61 as they beat Sterling 61-8. Clearwater blanks Belle Plaine 48-0. Cheney on top of Kingman 34-14. Watch out for the Cardinals from Cheney. Heston beats Haven 45-8. Remington and Douglas, they are tied at 22 apiece in the fourth. That is the latest that I heard. And again, if they finish the game off last night, we just didn't get a final. Hillsboro on top of Nickerson 50-22. And Conway Springs and Garden Plain at the half. The game got called. Conway Springs has a 7-6 lead. They will replay that game, or at least play the second half of that game, weather permitting, at 1 o'clock this afternoon. So if you want to go watch some good high school football, a couple of teams that like to just run the ball and play smash mouth football, get down to Conway Springs today at about 1 o'clock and check out the second half of Garden Plain and Conway Springs. We're going to head to a timeout on the other side of it. I'm going to probably wake Mason up. He is in Arlington. We will get Mason Voth on with us as he gets set to go to the K-State-Stanford game. So coming up in the final segment, we'll talk to Mason. We'll run down college football and the schedule today. We'll look at some college football games from last night. We'll also give you a schedule for both the Jayhawk Football Conference and the KCAC in their games today. That's next right here on the Saturday Morning Sports Page.
High school football season is here, and it's time for you to pick up a copy of the High School Football Guide from the Mid-America Sports Network. Keep track of your favorite teams as they fight their way to the state championships. Find a copy of your High School Football Guide
at Halstead Chiropractic, Red Dirt Jacks, Schmidt & Sons Incorporated, The Emporium, Travel & Smoke Barbecue, Tweetmeyer Dentistry, Vintage Bank of Kansas, Wellington Golf Club, and Weniger Drilling.
At Horse Trailer Sales, we make it easy to buy a trailer.
You've been running all around, but you still haven't found the kind of deal that you're looking for. Come on down and see us, and we're going to show you how we can save you so much more. We make it easy. We make it easy.
If you're looking for the right trailer at the right price, come on down to Horse Trailer Sales in Biola. They're making it easy to buy a trailer. Horse trailers, travel equipment, hitches, new and used trailers, and a whole lot more. Not only will you find selection, you'll find Horse Trailer Sales experience saves you more, and their service is the best. Horse Trailer Sales, a friendly and helpful staff of professionals who'll see to it that you get what you want at a price that you can afford, because they make it easy.
We make it easy.
Horse Trailer Sales, 6901 South 183rd Street West in Biola. Call 545-7292.
Clearwater Liquor, the home of all the beer, wine, and spirits that you may need in Clearwater, Kansas.
Whether it's for the big weekend game,
special occasion with friends and family, or you've just run out of that special drink, Clearwater Liquor has you covered. Weekly specials on all your favorites, and they pride themselves on great service with any of your needs. Clearwater Liquor, 560 North 4th Street in Clearwater. Open till 10 p.m. Monday through Thursday, 9 a.m. to 11 p.m. on Friday and Saturday, and even open 12 to 6 on Sunday.
Wichita Family Dental, East, West, and Derby Dental Care. At Wichita Family Dental, we handle general, restorative, cosmetic, and orthodontic needs in one location. No need for two appointments at two different offices, and we know how busy you are. At Wichita Family Dental, we value your time. Wichita Family Dental, Wichita's premier comprehensive state-of-the-art dental facility. East at 21st and Webb, West at 13th and Ridge, and Derby Dental Care of Derby at 1120 North Rock Road, Suite 100.
carrying the crafts of the top designers, and an in-house team that specializes in custom design, bridal jewelry, diamonds, and the ability to design a piece or ring just as unique as the recipient. Jewelry Savers in front of Cabela's at K96 and Greenwich Road has earned the reputation as Wichita's best. But don't take my word for it. Ask their customers, or better yet, experience Jewelry Savers for yourself.
We don't want $1 million, just a million friends.
Jeremy Edwards with Norris Collision Center of Goddard explains the Norris Collision Center difference.
That small door ding that's been bothering them since they bought the car, the air noise that it's always had since they've bought the car, we'll go over and above what just the insurance company says just to make sure it's a very memorable experience inside and out, and go that extra mile for them because we can afford to do that. We can take the time, as much time as we want, to make sure it's perfect.
Norris Collision Center of Goddard. See more at norriscollisioncenter.com.
Forecast for the Wichita metro area today, cooler highs below normal, high of 79. Rainfall for the majority of the day, heavier in the morning, and then decreasing by late this evening. Otherwise, some showers south of Wichita overnight tonight, down to 64 for the overnight low. Dry on your Sunday at a high of 84. I'm KAKE meteorologist Jeremy Vogel.
That's your latest KAKE First Alert weather update on Sports Radio KGSO.
At 7:42, it's currently 71 degrees.
The hell is this on a Saturday morning, man? I don't need to hear no Bee Gees on a Saturday morning. Who put this one in there? Saturday morning sports page, Fox Sports Radio, Wichita, KGSO. We've run down the high school football scores from last night a couple of times here on the show. We talked to Dusty Trail earlier this morning. Just got off the phone with Coach Brent Pfeiffer from the Mays South Mavericks. So now let's take a look at what is happening in college football for the day. Mason is down in Arlington as he gets set for his Cats to take on Stanford. It's an 11 a.m. kickoff. And Mason, we'll dive into your game coming up here in just a few moments. But from last night, I guess, you know, the one thing that sticks out is the Kansas Jayhawks, they get a win to open their season. It was ugly, 17-14 over South Dakota. So I lose my pick because I picked the Hawks with the spread. But at least KU got off the Lance Leipold era on the right foot here.
Yeah, it certainly wasn't pretty, and I really don't think any different of KU right now than I did a couple of months ago when the season ended for them. But the fact that they were able to kind of grind out that win, that's a step in the right direction from the Les Miles era, where we saw against inferior talent, close games at the end, they didn't find ways to win. They still will probably have to get over the notion that in some ways the game was gifted to them. I thought that the targeting slash late hit call on Jason Bean, the South Dakota DB comes in there a little late. I thought that was a little iffy and probably shouldn't have been called. And that obviously was a game-changing moment for KU, because instead of it being 4th-and-3 now and you're a ways back, you get even closer, and then the very next play they go and score a touchdown with not much time left. So that's really the only thing you can say to kind of take away from it. But really, like, at the end of the day, you just give a lot of credit to Lance Leipold for being able to come into a team that had so much dysfunction and finding a way to get them a win last night. And the other really positive note about all of this now is KU's going to have their non-con Power 5 game be against Duke this year. Duke lost last night to Charlotte, and Charlotte, that was their first win ever against the Power 5 team. So KU's going to have the opportunity to go ahead and get a second win in their non-conference before they even hit Big 12 play this year. So it's shaping up, I guess, to be at least a competitive start to the season for KU.
Yeah, well, I thought last night, and I didn't get to watch much of the game because by the time I got home, even though our game got cut short last night in Conway Springs, I mean, it was well into the third, almost the fourth quarter, so I didn't get to see a bunch of it. I didn't see the play that you just described. But what I did get to see out of it, I thought a couple of things to take away. One, Lance Leipold is very intense on the sidelines. I mean, I saw him get into a couple of coaches' face. You know, there was a time, I think, they had to burn a timeout because they didn't have enough players in on, like, a special teams, and that didn't make him happy. But I think what I saw last night is guys still are out of position when they play, but guys seem to be flying around a lot more, playing with a lot more intensity and playing a lot harder. So if they can build off that and fix some of those mistakes where guys are just out of position, I mean, who knows what Kansas can end up doing? They may actually get a Big 12 win or two.
Yeah, and I think really the big thing is as long as you get guys that are going to play and be ready to compete all season, that's already a little bit of a bonus from where you're at, where I think over the Les Miles course of things and the end of David Beatty, I'm not sure guys were playing hard as a team. I think that Lance Leipold and his mentality for at least the time being probably plays a little bit better for these guys. And we kind of heard it, you know, when Chris Klieman took over at K-State after the end of Bill Snyder and things had really changed drastically from what Snyder had built K-State into to where they were in 2018. That rejuvenated the players in 2019 when Klieman took over because they said it was different. It just something with the mentality there helped them. And I think that's the same thing for all these guys that have been in the program at KU. And then for the guys that are new there, they won't know anything different, but it's going to feel like legitimate Power 5 football to them. And that's really all you can hope for if you're KU at this point in time, is just keep inching closer and closer to better progress.
All right, and I thought last night a couple of other scores that were surprising. VaTech beats North Carolina 17-10, so the number 10 team goes down in week one. And then Michigan State goes into Northwestern and just puts a whooping on Northwestern. That was a little bit of a surprise. Michigan State may be a little bit better in the Big Ten than what we thought. Before we get to your game, let me give this schedule real quick. In the KCAC today, Iowa Western will play Dodge City at 1 o'clock. Independence plays Butler at Butler tonight at 7. And Hutch is on the road at Coffeyville at 7. I'm sorry, that's not the KCAC. That is the Jayhawk Conference. Now let's look at the KCAC with Tabor and Avila at 1 o'clock. Ottawa at Southwestern. Kansas Wesleyan will play at Friends tonight at 6. And St. Mary's is at Sterling. So there's your Jayhawk Conference schedule for today and your KCAC Conference schedule for today. The Wildcats, Kansas State, plays at 11 o'clock. FS1 is the channel for the kickoff. What has the vibe been? I know you got down there kind of late last night, but what has the vibe been so far down in Arlington? Is probably a lot of purple down there.
Yeah, I think it's been pretty positive. I mean, the entire way there you saw tons of different people with Kansas plates or K-State decals on their car from all different counties in Kansas. So it was just kind of nice to see. And there's definitely a good exodus of people that are coming down to watch the game. I think I saw a post yesterday from a parent of one of the K-State players. They were flying out of Kansas City down to Dallas yesterday, and they showed their entire flight full of people coming down for the game. So I think as many people that wanted to come and support the game are, and I think that's going to probably equate to about 30,000 people in the stands. And I tried putting a number on it yesterday. I would guess 27,000 will be K-State fans, 2,500 will be a bunch of just neutral observers, and maybe if Stanford's lucky, they'll have 500 people here, because I'm not entirely sure that Stanford fans know exactly where they're playing this weekend.
They probably don't. They're probably like, you want us to go where? We're not going to Texas.
Yeah. Exactly.
So have you changed? Because I know it took you longer to get down there. You ran into an accident really down in the southern part of Kansas, and then you ran into some rain. So it took you about 8 hours. Have you changed your tune yet? Have you come on board with me where, see, trips like that, you just got to get on a plane?
No, I'm still on team drive because a plane would have cost a lot more money than driving a car. So I'm on team financial savings would be where I would actually put myself. And yesterday probably did inch me closer to being like, wow, imagine if we had flown. But we got down here and it still wasn't horrible. If I had been by myself yesterday for the drive, that probably would have sent me over the edge. But I had my wife and brother-in-law with me, so that at least kept things interesting. And we made it, and hopefully the drive back makes things a little bit better and quicker.
I'm just telling you, if you had me in a car for 8 hours, you would hate me by the time we got there. Because it's just, I'm not into that kind of a deal at all.
I'm not saying that anybody liked me by the point we got here, especially my co-pilot. She was a little antsy the entire way. It was like I was back in driver's ed.
What do you expect today out of Kansas State? What are you looking the most forward to seeing for the Cats here on the football field today?
I think I'm interested, number one, to see how season two of Deuce Vaughn goes. I think last year was great. He's obviously a phenomenal player, and he's going to be in a really good battle this year to try and determine the top pecking order for running backs in the Big 12. I mean, obviously we know about Breece Hall, Bijan Robinson at Texas, got very minimal carries last year, but is going to be really, really good. And I think Deuce is going to have something to say to try and get into the mix and conversation with those two guys. But really the important ones after that, I mean, this defense is going to be challenged today in a lot of ways. And it's not solely because of what Stanford is going to do. It's just going to be because I think they have a lot of limitations when it comes to the linebackers. I'm still very concerned about what's going to go down there. And I'm just not sure it's going to be very pretty. The good news is Stanford's kind of shifted away from their power run game over the last couple of years. They put the ball in the air a little bit more now, and they're breaking in a new quarterback. Davis Mills, their starter from the past couple of years, he's with the Houston Texans now. So I think that's something that favors K-State. I feel pretty confident in their secondary. They got a transfer from Iowa and Julius Brent this offseason that I think is going to be all the part of a Big 12 defensive back. And so I'm feeling good about the rest of the defense. And the offense is going to have to stay healthy. We'll have to kind of see how the wide receivers fare this year. There are a lot of them that could play. There is one that is clear-cut better than everybody else in Malik Knowles, but he's had a lot of health problems over his first few seasons at K-State, and he's got to kind of get over that hump here later today. But I think K-State's going to come down, be ready to go, get a win. I think a lot of the players, and for sure the coaches, will be 100% excited to put last year behind them, because I don't think that's who they are, and I don't think that's what they want to be defined as.
A couple of other games in the Big 12 to pay attention to today. We talked about it on the show during the week, but Louisiana Lafayette, number 23 in the country, at number 21 Texas. That's a 3:30 game on Fox. I think that's going to be interesting. Texas Tech going up against Dana Holgorsen at Houston. That's on tonight on ESPN. Baylor's at Texas State. West Virginia is at Maryland. And then Tulane is at Oklahoma. This game was supposed to be played in at Tulane, but because of the hurricane, they moved it to Oklahoma. And I don't know if you saw this or not. I'm sure you did. But I did think it was a pretty cool move for Oklahoma. They're actually going to put Tulane's logo, stuff like that, on their field and make it try to feel as much like a home game until about, 85,000 people wearing crimsons show up to the game. But at least they're making an effort to make Tulane feel welcome.
Yeah, I thought it was a nice move. I've already seen some people like going way overboard, like, oh my goodness, what a great gesture by Oklahoma. It's a nice gesture, but it's two small logos at the 25-yard line. It's not like they painted midfield or the end zones for them. So I'm gonna try and put the fire out and be Mr. Fun Killer on that one, because I'm like, good move by Oklahoma. It wasn't a great move. They could have painted midfield for them.
Well, I think what the move was is it was like, we feel bad for you because you couldn't play this game at home and you have to come to our house. So we're going to make you feel welcome until about the end of the first quarter when we're up on you 30-0.
Yeah. You can do Tulane a favor and, like, at least let the game be close for a half.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
halftime, have the Tulane broadcast be like, hey, we may have something special going on here.
If you want to make a good gesture, spot them 28. I mean, start the game down 28-0.
Well, yeah, what's the spread for the game? It's like 31.5, I think.
Yeah, so, something like that. So
put Tulane up 31.5-0 to start the game.
11 o'clock kickoffs today. I'm not going to give you all of them because some of these games just suck, but Penn State at Wisconsin on Fox is probably, outside of K-State and Stanford, the game that most people will turn to. Oklahoma Tulane is on ABC. Fordham and Nebraska is on the Big Ten Network. Yay. RAS and Arkansas is on the SEC Network Plus at 1 o'clock. Just a little Danny Stuckey for you right there. And then really kind of the 2:30 games, there's not a lot of them that are that big. Most of the bigger games, I mean, you're going to have Alabama and Miami, I guess, if you consider that big. Indiana and Iowa, that's probably your two best games at the 2:30 kickoff.
I think, you know, really in the afternoon window, Iowa State playing at home against Northern Iowa. Northern Iowa is always really scrappy and normally a really good FCS team, and they've given Iowa State some issues in the past. Now, this isn't the same, you know, Iowa State team that it was 2 years ago when they went to overtime against Northern Iowa, but I don't think Iowa State's going to cover the 31.5 that they're being given today.
We'll see, man. I like this Iowa State team. We'll see what they do. All right, well, enjoy the game today. Have fun and be careful coming back.
Sounds good. We'll see you on Tuesday.
All right. There he goes, Mason Voth. Down in Arlington, K-State, Stanford today, 11 o'clock kickoff on FS1. That's it. The first Saturday morning sports page in the books. Appreciate everybody watching the show across the four streaming channels and listening on 1410 AM, 93.9 FM. First week of high school football in the books as well. Have a good holiday weekend. Mason and I will see you Tuesday morning.
Are you experiencing anxiety?
Am I going crazy?
Intense cravings? Delirium? If so, you may be experiencing football withdrawal. Oh.